beautiful people, welcome back to Mimsy Bids. I am Marwa, aka Mimsy. Today I really wanted to talk about a campaign, hashtag it is not a choice. And this is referring to the hijab. This campaign actually got started by Atheist Muslim South Africa. So thanks guys for doing this. I think it's really, really important to highlight the fact that, you know, with hijab comes actually so much oppression around the world for so many girls and women. Now, I actually have a whole video on hijab and shaming culture. And in that video, I go into a lot of detail about the hijab and, you know, my kind of experience with the hijab and just some stories in there. So if you'd like to know a little bit more about that kind of stuff, I've already got it on my channel. I'll have the link below. Definitely go check out that video. So I obviously am an ex-Muslim. I grew up Muslim and grew up in a Muslim community. And I know for so many of you out there, if you are Muslim or you've come from Muslim communities, you either had been forced to wear the hijab or you know someone that's been forced to wear the hijab. I feel like in Arab countries, Muslim countries, you know, you would definitely be familiar with that. And definitely knowing kind of London and the Muslims and kind of the UK based, you know, there's always someone in your community, if not the whole community or everyone around you, that's pretty much been forced to wear the hijab. So what's really frustrating is that people ignore this. You know, you focus on like, it's a choice, but ultimately there are so many girls that have been indoctrinated with this from such a young age. I mean, I wore the hijab from the age of 5 and learned about why girls should be covering from boys at that really, really young age. And of course that immediately makes you a sort of sexual being. And you suddenly understand something that perhaps you shouldn't really think about when you're that age. And it's obligatory to wear it when you become a woman, which is when you start your period. So it literally could be as young as 8 or 9, you're considered a woman and you have to cover your body from boys and men. So if you were just someone who wanted a dress like that, and that's kind of how you like to dress, that's one thing. But firstly, being told as a small child that actually this is obligatory, you have to do this, it's an order from God, and if you don't do it, you will be punished, because you will be punished if you don't carry out an order from God. You know, I mean, there's nothing more serious than an order from God, basically. So as I've said before on my channel, that, you know, to call it a choice, even just without the family, just for a second, if we ignore the whole family and community aspect of it, just the Islamic understanding, it's literally like putting a gun to someone's head and saying, well, if you don't do this, it's your choice, but if you don't do this, I'll shoot you in the head. That's not really a choice. You know, Muslims always tell me, well, it is a choice because you can choose to be Muslim or not. You can have the choice. But if you believed this, then it's terrifying. And it's literally a violent, horrible threat that you've got if you don't do it.
If you look at not abiding by the hijab, a woman who shows her hair or wears revealing clothes, is this a major sin or not? The Prophet told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, and the hadith is in the Sahih, that there are two types of people he did not see, yet they are among the people of hell. And he mentioned one of them to be women who are dressed yet nude, meaning that either they're wearing transparent clothes, you can see through it, so that she's actually nude, or she's wearing tight clothes that reveals her awrah. So the Prophet told us that they are from the people of hell. In another hadith, he said, curse them because they are cursed by Allah Azza wa Jal, which is an indication that this is indeed a major sin.
Is hijab something important? It is. How important it is for women, the hijab is as important as praying. Really? Yes, because it has been ordained in Allah by Allah in His Quran, ayah number 59 of Surah Al-Ahzab for your reference. Will I be responsible for my wife's misbehavior? Yes, you will. You're a family father, that's your responsibility.
How in any way does that make it freedom of choice? How is that freeing and liberating? Then on top of that, there are Muslim countries out there such as Iran and Saudi Arabia where it is mandatory by law to wear the hijab. So if they weren't to wear hijab, they could be punished by the government. In fact, Saudi Arabia includes the burqa, the full black garment, the abaya. That is also mandatory. So there are so many women who just don't have this basic human right of being able to choose how they dress. So I actually asked you guys to send me some of your stories. I was scrolling through my emails and some comments and things like that, just kind of seeing people's stories. That's really what I wanted. People's stories with hijab, what they experienced. And to be honest with you, it was extremely repetitive. We experience the same thing. If we don't experience it ourselves, we see it around us. And like Muslim women out there, you know exactly what I'm talking about, because I was a religious Muslim woman, okay? And I knew very well that my friends were not allowed to leave the house without hijab. You know, I feel like there's this strong defense whenever any of the ex-Muslims speak out against hijab. They're like, no, we are all great, we're fine. Yeah. In some countries, they force women to wear it, like Saudi and Iran, but we don't all have that, and actually we like wearing it. You know, they're super, super defensive. But I know that you guys know. I know that you know, because I knew as a Muslim, we know. Like, what's the most frustrating is this denial of this oppression. Yes, there are women that are forced to do it who might not necessarily want to do it, or maybe want the freedom to choose what the hell they put on their own bodies. So, I wanted to read out just a couple of the stories I got, and I feel like these stories were, as I said, super repetitive. So it was like literally the same story over and over and over again from all kinds of Muslim girls from all over the world. I was told by my parents I have to wear hijab if I want Allah's reward and to have a pious husband. I've been wearing the hijab from the age of 10. I hate meeting new people because I feel like wearing the hijab isn't me I'm introducing them to. I've been feeling really depressed and would rather just stay at home, which is what my parents would prefer anyway. I tried to wear nicer clothes and a turban hijab style once, and my dad told me there's no way that I'm leaving the house like that, even though I was actually totally covered. So this is a long email. She goes on to say that any of her big life choices, decisions in her life, aren't made by her and are ultimately made by her father. Her dad has to approve of what she's doing. And she's a 22-year-old young woman. And that particular point about identity was definitely something that was reoccurring in a few others that I've read. You know, you don't have an identity in your clothing. If it is that you just have to dull down, you know, for many girls that wear just jilbab, like black, hijab, niqab, you don't have any other identity except for you're a Muslim woman. And actually, on a psychological level, you know, it's so important to have your own identity in that way. Okay, so next email. When I was 7, I started to wear hijab to school. My parents made Islam and being Muslim fun and something to be proud of, and my identity that made me different to the other kids. I felt like I was special up until I was about 14. I then realized there wasn't any freedom or choice in this. I had to wear this hijab. As fun as you can try and paint it, I was indoctrinated as a child who didn't understand. I may have chosen to put it on at 7, but now at 19, I don't have the choice to take it off. This feels like a prison sentence that I wasn't old enough to agree to. Honestly, reading that, I'm like trying to not cry. Like, I literally have shivers because this is a reality for so many girls. What do these girls do? There's no way, you know, they don't see a way out because they have to obey. They've been taught to obey, and if they don't obey, they lose everything. I'll read the next one. I live in London and wear hijab and jilbab. My dad and brothers would beat me if they were to even see hair coming out of my hijab. They constantly criticize the way girls wear the hijab these days. If it were up to me, I wouldn't be wearing the hijab and jilbab. I am actually a Muslim writing this, and I don't have a choice whether or not to wear the hijab and jilbab. I do still believe in Allah, and I have my own struggles with my religion, but I always wish I had a choice with hijab. I actually had a few converts that converted to Islam and then were told, you should wear hijab because you're Muslim, this is what you do, here you go. And they were like, oh, okay, kind of like in the spur of the moment. And then now, in retrospect, they're like, shouldn't that have been something I decided? Which I know a lot of converts do decide to do. But this is really important to show the other side, because it's like the other side isn't shown enough. This is literal torture, imprisonment for people. They can't choose how to live their own lives, how to dress their own bodies. And people would rather just brush past it and not really look at it and just focus on, and you know, in the Muslim community, just talk about how it's a feminist thing, how it's great, how we have this amazing hijab that protects us. And they don't ever discuss the fact that so many girls are literally dying inside because they don't choose to do this. So I had 3 emails from Somali girls who actually know each other. They come from the same community and they were speaking to me, they were like all friends, and they were speaking to me about their community that they come from. And their community, I won't give too many details obviously, they were saying that it's actually dangerous for them to not be in the full hijab and jilbab. You know, if they were seen by someone in their Somali community, their life would actually be threatened and all would be just, you know, beaten to a pulp. And that's something that is really common in their particular community, for the men to really beat their wives, their sisters, and really control them through violence, which is super scary. And of course, happens all, not just the Somali community, it happens in all communities. I've actually seen that in my own family and my extended family, where there's been men beating their wives, particularly because they were not behaving in the Islamic wifely way, or they weren't dressed appropriately according to their own standards. Okay, so I'll leave it there. I just wanted to point out how important it is to show the oppression that happens behind closed doors with hijab. And it's not just hijab, actually. You know, hijab is just like a branch of the oppression that happens within Islamic communities, within Islam. And I have touched on a few different things before. Obviously, I made a video on are women oppressed in Islam, and the way that there is a huge power difference between men and women within the religion of Islam. So there is actually a lot more that I didn't go into. You know, I want this just to be kind of quick video supporting this campaign. If you want me to go into the kind of the verses and the hadiths and really kind of go in depth and showing the root of this view of women and this oppression of women, I can absolutely do that. So if you'd like me to do a video on that, comment down below. And if enough of you want to see it, then I'll make a video on that too. If you are someone out there that's really, really struggling at the moment with hijab, you know, please don't just suffer alone. Drop me an email, but there are also so many organizations out there. I'll have them down below so you can check them out. You can speak to people who are also going through this, because guess what? You're really not alone. There's so many of you out there who are going through the same exact struggle. And you know, it's so important for campaigns like this to highlight it. We don't just ignore people that are suffering and stop making it as if it's kind of like Islamophobic to mention that so many girls are oppressed by it, because it's just fact. Anyway, guys, like this video, comment down below, subscribe to my channel, and I'll see you guys soon. Stay in touch. Mwah.